Welcome to the Israel United in Christ podcast with the real Jews, the 12 tribes of Israel, where you get the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth from the words of the Most High straight from the Bible. Join us each week as the prophets break down the deep basics, unlock Bible mysteries, expose dangerous deceptions, and show you how to come back to your true heritage and inherit the kingdom of heaven. These are revelations and insights you won't get anywhere else. So he that has an ear, let him hear, because the prophets are about to speak.
To the Most High for awarding us another day to do His work. All praises to the Most High. We got a special show for y'all today. For many of you who tuned in last week, you know, we had the pleasure of having one of our mighty bishops here, Bishop Nathaniel, last week. We also had Deacon Labaka in the house, Deacon Malachi in the house. So it was a powerful. Aura in that thing.
Monumental.
It was monumental.
All praises for that.
All praises to the Most High for that thing.
Yeah.
But today we have another great show lined up for y'all.
Powerful show. We got a powerful show, man.
Another monumental show. Okay? I'll let Officer Amaziah go more into it of who we have here with us today.
Today we have a brother. This brother brought it to our attention that he did a little research on his name.
Matter of fact, why don't we let him introduce
him.
Let's let the brother start off. What is your name?
Let everybody know your name, where you're from, and why are you here today?
Shalom to all Israel. I'm here today.
Talk right in.
I'm here today to share a little light on a little history, not only concerning my family, but concerning our whole family, as a whole, nation as a whole.
What's your name, brother?
My name is Jared Godley.
Okay. This is Brother Jared Godley. Right. Okay.
Where are you from? I come from Louisiana. Born and raised in Louisiana. My parents come from the Midwest.
Okay.
From Wisconsin, but concerning the truth. And history. I came into it by way of a lot of family lineage, family study, studying my background, my father and my grandfather's lineage, and I used genealogy.com to do a lot of that. But
So what you did was you had some questions about your family.
Yeah.
You had some questions about your family, so you went on to genealogy.com in order to find out some more about, you know, your heritage, right? Okay.
Right. I was trying to find out some things about my heritage, you know, just basic things, because knowing us, we don't have a lot of history.
Right.
We don't know a lot. The further you go back, the more you run into slaves, the more you run into slave masters' accounts, mm-hmm. of his stock, basically,
right,
on
right.
the plantation.
Absolutely.
And through that, I kept seeing Negro as it concerned my ancestors, Negro, Negro, Negro. And at the same time, I was hearing brothers speak about who the Negroes really were.
Okay.
So putting all of that together, I was using the census, because that's what genealogy.com goes off of mostly, is the census.
United States Census, right?
United States Census.
Okay.
I saw my family move from the plantation literally into regular American life, if you will, based on the Emancipation Proclamation and the end of the Civil War.
Okay.
So I was amazed at first that our people own their own homes by that time, which was a relatively short time.
Around what time period is that?
This is the late 1800s, around 1860s, 70s, okay. 80s, because the census comes out every 10 years.
Right,
you
right.
see these records, you see where you're, if you follow the last name, that is, you see these Negro Godleys,
right.
or these Negro Johnsons,
right.
you know, move off of the plantation. They still worked on the plantation, by the way.
Because, let me say this, in the census, they actually, that's why they separate you by your race, because they want to know who's the slave and who's the slave master.
Right. So
that's why they'll put Negro Johnson or Negro Jackson, okay? Because it's not talking about the census taken by the so-called white man. It's not talking about the slave master. These are the slaves.
Right. And around 1900, that census had my family in Pierce County, Missouri. To find that out, I just did a little backtracking from what my father and my uncles knew about the family. And
so you had heard family, mm-hmm. they taught you certain things.
It literally started with the murder of my great-grandfather in Milwaukee, Wisconsin in 1920.
Okay.
So if you can trace back the census every 10 years, you see James Godley as a boy, as a young man, as a boy, and then you see his father and his mother.
And let the people know, who was James Godley to you?
James Godley is my grandfather's father.
Okay, your grandfather's father.
So he would have been the first generation in Wisconsin.
Mm-hmm.
So moving backwards, I see all of his family coming from Kentucky.
Okay.
And we see some census around then, but before Kentucky, they were in Missouri.
Missouri.
So okay. when I got to Missouri, there was a gap in the history, in the census. Literally from 1900 to 1910, the family changed and was in a whole different county in Missouri. I always wondered why. Never knew why. But it was just one of the holes in the story. I really kind of dismissed it because there was no knowledge, but I came upon a PBS documentary called Vanished.
Mm.
It's one of the Independent Lens episodes. And it was on Pierce County, Missouri. Also Forsyth County, Georgia.
Right.
And another county in Arkansas. Harrison County in Arkansas.
Okay.
And it was chronicling the movement of Negroes from these three areas, mainly. I guess you would call that the Midwest or the breadbasket of America. Right.
Used to be a saying, don't let the sun go down on you in Forsyth County.
My dad always told me that the family was run out of Pierce City.
The mob stood shoulder to shoulder and just fired across into what we believe was the black community.
When you start to read these things, you're stunned by it. How do we cure the past, in a sense?
With the black-owned land in Forsyth County, what you see is a sale from somebody to a black landowner. And then you don't see the next deed.
Adverse possession is the way that people have of taking title to property without buying it.
The whole culture of this area evolved out of the eviction of those African Americans from Pierce City.
When I was down there trying to find my great-grandfather's grave, and they would not help me find his grave, and the gravedigger turned and said, nobody's gonna dig a grave up here ever. My goal is to get James exhumed and moved to Springfield.
I'll help you if I can, Charles. Okay. That's all I can tell you.
Okie doke.
Dom said that Charles was going to send the city a bill for $6,000. It's upset me very much.
I don't think there's any amount of money that'll ever change the heartache that was caused in 1901. It still would have the same hurt.
But when I read the, when I saw the episode, rather, I noticed that there is a poster mentioned in the episode that said Negroes banished from Pierce County. And on that flyer is the names of those that were missing from that 1910 census.
Oh, really? So remember, you mentioned that
there was a gap.
So now, as you're watching this PBS special, banished about those Negroes who were banished from these certain parts of the United States, that gap is now being filled in front of your eyes.
In front of my eyes.
All praises.
All praises to the Most High.
Definitely all praises.
Okay.
Because I was searching for myself when this was happening. Mm-hmm. And finding out our true heritage alongside historical and you know, facts, documents, proof, you know, was made a tremendous light go off.
You know?
That's it.
Yeah, tremendous, bright light.
Yeah, yeah, you know? Yeah.
And, all praises. If you've ever been guided spiritually, you know what I'm talking about.
Right.
All praises to the Most High. Remember, Christ said, "My sheep hear my voice." You know, at the same time you're hearing the truth, at the same time you're trying to connect the dots with your families, bong, and it all connects, man. All praises to the Most High.
Just like a puzzle piece.
All praises.
So what actually happened was, this is from the headlines. White woman lynched in murdered in Pierce County, Missouri.
Okay, white woman murdered in Pierce County, Missouri.
Right.
Okay.
Will Godley, which is my great-great-great uncle, was accused of the crime. Mm. He was not the perpetrator of the crime.
Oh, yeah. Because you know what? Because when our brothers are accused, especially during that time, oh, they gotta be guilty. So, but what it is that they found, just like now, they put out a description. They put out a description.
Bolo, yeah. Be on the lookout.
Yeah, be on the lookout for a tall, slender Negro in a white shirt.
That fits like 85% of Negroes, man.
That's why normally during lynchings, it wasn't just one brother that was lynched. It's usually a group of them that are lynched because they capture multiple brothers that fit that description. And then those who just like now when you don't answer a police officer directly or in a timely fashion of when he asks you, you might get your behind whipped.
Right.
Same thing back then. If you didn't answer, even if you didn't fit the description, if you didn't answer certain questions in a timely fashion as they were asking you and it didn't connect, you were getting lynched too. It was like a 2-for-1 buffet deal.
Right.
Okay, this woman, her name was Giselle Wilde, evidently was coming home from church And the story is,
she's a white woman.
She's a white woman.
Yeah.
And by the way, the story sounds, you know, a bit contrived.
Of course. We're going to read about it. I got it right here in the book. We're going to read about it next.
And she was on her way home from church. And it said that her younger brother was 10 minutes behind her. Mm-hmm. And when she was accosted by a black male and murdered. Mm. It's also said that a farmer witnessed it. Though, you know, that's a little sketchy too. And what happened is they immediately sought out my uncle and I think a cousin of his and arrested them. Mm. And the lynch mob came.
Oh yeah.
Which is familiar, I'm sure, you know, across America with our
right.
people, how it happened. They came, broke him out of the sheriff's jail and lynched him on the porch of the hotel in town.
Yep.
Under the awning.
Under the awning.
Under the awning. Shot him, you know, and in the process killed one of their own children with the stray bullets. And you know, basically tried him, convicted him, all in the span of a few hours.
Right, executed.
The real culprit, they say, and I really don't have a lot of faith in that either, was some Pullman porter on a railroad, on the train that passes through there. And they were waiting for him also, but I don't think he ever came back.
Yeah.
But in particular, those things finally closed, you know, that big gap in my family's history and really reinforced to me who I am, where I come from, and who we really are as a people.
That's right.
Absolutely, brother. Let's get a script real quick. We read this yesterday concerning Sandra Bland about what's going on with that sister now, you know. She basically got lynched in her jail cell with a garbage bag. Cause you know when you get processed into the prison, they take your shoelaces off for you so you don't your belt, anything you can harm yourself with. So how in the hell she get a garbage bag? So come on, let's use some common sense. All right, they lynched her in the damn jail cell, man. So let's go to Leviticus 26 and verse 14. Leviticus 26 and 14. Let's see what the Most High has said concerning the children of Israel for our own disobedience.
Right. The book of Leviticus, chapter 26 and verse 14. But if ye will not hearken unto me, and will not do all these commandments, and if ye shall despise my statutes, or if your soul abhor my judgments.
If your soul abhor, meaning hate the Most High God's judgments. Go ahead.
So that ye will not do all my commandments.
Because what we did was break the Most High God's commandments. Go ahead.
But that ye break my covenant.
And in turn, we break the Most High God's covenant. Go ahead.
I also will do this unto you.
What has the Most High done to us?
I will even appoint over you terror.
What?
Terror.
You hear that? So the Most High God, remember, his name is Elishadia. Which means great and terrible power. Okay, the Most High is a terrible God, man. This should strike fear in all of us, man. But we go along like it's, you know, God is a I could put it in my pocket. He's like a little teddy bear.
Right.
No, he's a terrible God.
Right.
These things, even though he's used the white man to do these things to us. Remember, the scripture says man's goings is of the Lord, man.
That's right.
He put the spirit on this devil. He put the spirit in that devil to do what he's done, man.
That's right.
Okay?
That's something all people don't understand.
They don't understand that. I don't know what it's going to take. Negroes are getting lynched in their jail cells now. If y'all saw the video, the cop had a sister. I saw something disturbing as hell. When the cop, y'all probably didn't see it. The cop, you saw it yesterday in the thing. The cop had in the back seat of his car a sister hogtied.
Yeah, that's right.
And pulled her out like she was a piece of cattle, like she was a damn horse or something.
Right.
Or a pig.
moment a Florida police officer literally dragged hogtied homeless woman into jail like a rag muffin. A Tampa, Florida, police officer has been disciplined for dragging a restrained homeless woman on the floor after she was arrested for smoking crack cocaine. The incident took place last October and was caught on a surveillance camera inside the parking garage at the Hillsborough County Jail. The brief clip shows Officer Scott Vantrees remove the suspect from the back seat of a cruiser and place her on the floor. The woman, 36-year-old Sonia Meminger, has her hands and feet restrained, and she is seen lying flat on her stomach with her legs bent at the knees, Tampa Bay Times reported. Vantrees takes off the suspect's restraints and attempts to get her to stand up, but Meminger collapses to the floor.
Untie her, and her limp body just stayed in the same damn position, man. White man is the devil the Bible speaks of. Right. What else is it going to take for you to understand that? I don't know. Y'all Negroes are dead asleep. If we're going to read some atrocities today,
that's right.
We're going to read about how American ghettos were started. We're going to read about how they lynched and burned our bodies. But you look at your brother in the ghetto that was forced to be in the ghetto with you as your damn enemy, and you want to put him to death.
Right.
Y'all niggas got to wake up, man. Finish that script.
I got you.
Leviticus chapter 26 and verse 15. And if ye shall despise my statutes, or if your soul abhor my judgments, so that ye will not do all my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, I will also do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror.
So the white man is the damn terrorist on this earth.
That's right.
He's terrorized us for 400 years plus.
That's right.
The Native Americans, 600 plus. Okay, he is the terrorist on this planet. Okay? As the Ku Klux Klan. Now as your police force. That's the damn terrorists, man.
That's right.
They terrorize you so much you forgive them for killing your own damn mama. Mm-hmm. That's how terrorized you are in America.
Right.
So damn fearful, man. Go ahead.
Consumption. And the burning ache.
Diseases. Go ahead.
That shall consume the eyes.
Go ahead.
And cause sorrow of heart.
What's sorrow of heart? Depression, man. That's why all you niggas, you want to get high. You want to take drugs.
Right.
You want to medicate yourself in the damn oppression, man.
To numb the pain.
To numb the pain, man.
And to really mask your fear.
Exactly.
Because we're so fearful, what we have to do is, what is that called? Liquid courage.
Liquid courage.
Right. Yeah. You gain liquid courage. You get drunk. All of a sudden, you're a
mighty. You're a Superman or something.
Yeah. Get that liquid.
You're okay.
Right.
Go ahead.
And cause sorrow of heart, and ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it.
Meaning what? Well, all your labor is for your damn enemy. It benefits your enemy while we basically live paycheck to paycheck, man.
Right.
You sow your seed in vain. Go ahead.
And I will set my face against you.
And what?
I will set my face against you.
That, you in those churches think the Most High God is with you. Most High God ain't with you in those churches, man. Right. The proof is Charleston, South Carolina.
That's right.
You prayed to who you thought was the Most High God for a whole hour. I don't even pray for a whole hour at a time. Right. And then you get put to death right after you pray for an hour? Mm-hmm. If that doesn't... cause you something to go up in your head, like a red flag, wait a minute. They were just praying for an hour to who they thought was the Most High God. Then the Most High God allowed them to get put to death.
Yeah.
I thought they were supposed to be all Holy Ghost saved in that church.
I thought they were saved.
I thought they were saved. The Negro in America claims to be saved in them churches.
Right.
So how come the Most High God allowed you to be put to death in your church?
Right.
Somebody call in and answer that, Christian. Mm. I need a Christian to answer me that. Show me in the Bible, why did the Most High God kill those people that claim to be saved? And a pastor. The pastor was there, right?
They had all the images and all the artwork and none of that work, the crucifixes.
You had all the so-called protection in your church, didn't you? You had the crucifix. You had two big white Jesus pictures in the damn church. Mm. But wait a minute. The white man didn't protect you, did he?
Mm-hmm.
No. He put you to death.
That's right.
Go ahead. You got y'all something?
Yeah, I wanted to bring something out real quick.
Good. No. Finish that first.
Verse 17. And I will set my face against you,
and ye shall be slain before your enemies.
So this is what we're reading about today, being slain before our enemies. Right now, we turned away from our power of the Most High God.
That's right.
We turned away from being gods to be Negroes. So we'd be under our slave, under our slaves. Today, the Negro is under his slave.
That's right.
That should be something. Let that sink in. Medicate your brain with that. Your slave is making laws against you. Think about it. Go ahead.
They that hate you.
Oh, they that love me.
They that hate you.
What if they give me welfare in Section 8?
They that hate you.
The Bible says they, the people that hate you, the people that terrorize you, the people that burned your houses, burned your bodies, cut off your ears, cut off your penises, sold them for souvenirs after they lynched your body, shot you 100 times, shot your limp body 100 times,
shall reign over you.
You hear that? Now they reign over you. For our own wickedness, they reign over us.
Right.
They pass laws against us. Now they pass laws for us to be homosexuals.
That's right.
And they also pass laws that you cannot move to certain towns. Those are the policies of America. We're going to read about that today. You think your situation being all blacks primarily in the ghetto is by accident? No, 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 no. We're going
to
read about that today too.
It's by design.
It's all by design, by your enemies that hate you.
That's right.
Good. Well,
and ye shall flee when none pursue you.
See that? And ye shall flee when none pursue. Good. Well, right.
Real quick, let me have Psalms 145 and start at verse 5. I want verse 5 and 6.
All right. This is the book of Psalms, chapter 145, verse 5.
Uh-huh.
And it says, I will speak of the glorious honor of thy majesty and of thy wondrous works.
So now, we all can speak of the wondrous works of the Most High God. He's made the trees, he's made the birds, he's made the ocean, all the living things on the planet. So his wondrous works are evident.
Mm-hmm.
But here's the one thing that our people on a general consensus have no clue pertains to the Most High God. Read verse 6.
Absolutely. Verse 6. And men shall speak of the might of thy terrible acts.
Wait a minute. God has terrible acts?
I thought he was all loving.
Wait a minute.
I thought it was like a little teddy bear in my pocket.
Wait a minute. So that means, wait. So we can understand the wondrous works of the Most High God, but we can't understand that the Most High God is who sets up these terrible things on this planet.
Right.
Y'all in the church praying to the wrong one. That's the thing. And what, he showed you one of his terrible acts by sending that demon in there to put our people to death.
Right.
Why is that? Because you refuse to keep his commandments, man. You refuse to stop worshiping that white devil with the blonde hair and blue eyes y'all call Jesus.
Right.
Y'all
that
love
is
him.
That is not the Christ. Mm-hmm. But there was a big-ass picture of him in there.
That's right.
Two of them.
It was two of them.
Two of them.
Two of them. Two big old banners flapping in the wind.
Wait, officer, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Hold up. In that church, that AME church is a historical church. The African Methodist Episcopal Church. Denmark Vesey tried to start a slave revolt, as that was the base of his slave revolt. But wait a minute, how are you gonna have a historical so-called black church with the white image of Christ in there? It
makes no sense.
And you're supposed to be about revolution. You ain't about no damn revolution.
Hell no.
You about serving your slave master.
That's it.
Let's get the facts straight, man.
It ain't about no revolution.
You ain't about no revolution.
Right.
Revolution is repentance.
Because
that's what revolution is.
Guess what, officer? If they were about revolution, wouldn't putting your brothers, your mama, your uncles, and all that were killed in that church reason to rise up and say, you know what? To hell with y'all white supremacy. Wouldn't that be reason enough to do that?
Yes, sir.
I think it would be a fuel for the fire.
Absolutely.
If you have that revolutionary spirit in you, right, all you need is a little fuel to get it going.
Mm-hmm.
If that devil putting 9 brothers and sisters to death wasn't enough fuel, I don't know what the hell else is.
Maybe more got to go. I don't know.
And you know what?
Y'all don't
scriptures
wake
tell
up.
Us more going to have to go.
That's right.
That's what the Bible
says. The Bible says that.
More, well, we forgive them. I forgive him though.
In 24 hours, you forgive the devil for killing your mama. I still can't get over it. That's crazy. That shows how crazy we are, man.
It's been 100 years and I haven't forgiven these people.
That's right. All praise. All praise. And the Bible doesn't teach you to forgive all things either.
Not at all. It doesn't. Right.
Because they're still here.
Exactly. Exactly.
Men of Israel, let's rise to the battle, calling all soldiers, officers, captains, deacons, elders, warriors of the Most High God. The Lord has called us to the vineyard to take back what is rightfully ours, our nation.
We be the warriors, the Most High sent, so you know there is no destroying us. Ordained from the womb, prophets back from the tomb, to cast out all these false doctrines that is out to consume. Your chosen people, talking about we equal. Yo, pass a lion in their pulpit, they're deceitful. Not to mention that they ordained by the same man that took your land and labeled all of us some Negroes. So gon' get it right. Yeah, he gon' return like a thief in the night. So no plan, yeah, no plan. Scriptures cutting, demons slaying. Yeah, you Christians stuck in Neverland like that Peter Pan. And I we ain't pretending to. Unlike these heathens out here screaming they identical. We the warriors, Most High Army glorious. We ain't stopping till we see our nation is victorious.
We warriors for the Most High. Step to us and you better get the ride.
A nation bred in affliction, a lineage of kings and priests who stray from my positions. Listen, a warrior's mission is repentance, return in Christ and live our lives and love the one who gives it. This is blissful if you with it, hate if you against it. Gotta navigate through the fake. These scriptures help us see him, imitators wanna be him. Chosen nation, chosen people, can't compare us, ain't no equal. Call this rise of the Hebrews. And the guy who served don't play. Say the hell up out of my way. It's all gas and no brakes. Yeah, we striving for the kingdom, and I can't wait to see him. Lord, I just can't wait to see you. Know you in me, I can feel you. Give me knowledge, give me wisdom. Understanding in these scriptures, running circles round these Christians. I can hear you, cause I feel you. Be a fool if I ain't listen. I'm a warrior for the Lord. Eyes focus on the mission.
We warriors for the Most High. Step to us and you better get in the ride.
My brethren, be strong in the Lord, in the power of his might, put on the whole armor of God.
That ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil.
Flesh and blood, we don't wrestle, we operate as his vessels. Oracles bringing the message, scriptures like nuclear missiles. Spiritual wickedness, we dismiss it. Commandments of the Lord, we be living. Sing the song, they be feeling. He bringing spiritual healing. The old man, we be killing. We serve the Most High because
before he is the Most High.
We ain't playing with, put the scriptures in it. We
conditioned to think the way you do. But it's high time, come out of sleep and reclaim your nationality. 'Cause you're not like all these other people. You are Israel. You're a set apart people. Oh yeah. Come out of her. You're a set apart people. Oh yeah. Come out of her. Come out of her. Now before he formed you in your mother's womb, all these nations, oh yeah, oh yeah, and that is why you gotta keep his laws in the faith of his son, the black Messiah. And don't join in with these other nations, they're not like you. You're a set apart people. Oh yeah, come out of her. You're a set apart people. Oh yeah, come out of her, come out of her. Israel, please separate and rely on your own people. 'Cause as you look around, we're not equal. Israel, there's gonna come a day when we will see Christ. And he's not just saving you, but us together. You're a set apart people. Oh yeah, come out of her. You're a set apart people. Oh yeah, come out of her. You're a set apart people.
Okay, so let's go into the brother's story now. We got a book called, some of you have this book, it's called 100 Years of Lynching by Ralph Ginzburg. Ginzburg, probably a fake Jew.
Probably.
Right? Sound like a fake Jew right there. But let's see what this devil documented. We're going to page 41. This is in the Chicago Herald, August 20th, 1901. Right here.
All right. Page 41.
We're going to read now about what happened in Pierce City, Missouri, with the brothers' family.
The headline reads from the...
And 1 second. It behooves all of you brothers and sisters in the sound of our voices to go do a little research on your family. Go research these things out like the brother researched himself. Man, let me see, where did my family come from? Even in America, because guess what? Guess what we don't know? After physical slavery, chattel slavery, blacks spread out not only to Chicago, New York, and LA. We were in Nebraska, we were in Arkansas, we were in Missouri, we were in Wyoming, we were all North Dakota, we was everywhere, we were spread out everywhere. But guess what your friendly neighborhood white man did? He would put a fake charge on a brother and say, hey, this brother was messing with a white woman. Lynch the brother, maybe two or three others with him, kill them, shoot their bodies up, and then burn down all the black people's homes, and the black people move out. That's called ethnic cleansing.
That's right.
That's what it's called. That this was in the late 1800s, early 1900s. No, excuse me, up until about 1968.
Right.
1968, when Jim Crow ended. Okay, and that's what created ghettos today. So you ever wonder why when you was a kid and you're in the hood, you ever wonder why the majority of our people are in the ghettos? It's because of what happened back in the early 1900s. and you never went back to those sundown towns, because that's what they're called now, sundown towns. Okay, whites only. Nigga be gone before sundown. They used to put that on the city limits. Don't let the sun go down on you in Hawthorne, California, or wherever.
And that was heavy in the Midwest too.
That was heavy in the Midwest, and that was even in the West Coast.
Yep.
And it was heavy in Midwest, like Chicago, Illinois.
You know what? That's heavy in
America. Huh? It's all over America.
All over America.
Yeah. Because when you drive through, let's be honest, if you're in the South and you're driving at night, let's say 2-3 in the morning, let's say you're on the highway, or running through these little small towns, if you know damn well you are feeling like, man, I hope my car don't break down here.
Hell yeah.
You already know, and it's 2015, and these are the things that happened in the early 1900s, man.
Hey, brother, sometimes you'll be driving somewhere, and let's say you need gas or something, or you need something. You looking around, you're like, man, I don't see no black folks around here. Let me go to the next station.
Right.
Let me go to the next one, and the next one. Because you're like, nah, it's too many white folks around here. I'm a little nervous.
Right.
Right.
So,
right.
Yes, we do have that feeling.
Right.
When you the only so-called black person around in the area, I ain't stopping there. I'm good.
And it's in you already. To see that, like, it's already in you. But now we're gonna get the facts of why it's in you and why do we feel that way?
Go ahead, we'll bring it out.
This is an article from the Chicago Record Herald. That's their newspaper, August 20th, 1901, on page 41.
Shooting at lynched black. So the man is already dead, correct? Shooting at lynched black. Go ahead.
Mob kills boy bystander.
And the mob kills the little boy. Go ahead.
Pierce City, Missouri, August 19th. Eugene Carter and another Negro named Godley were taken from jail tonight and lynched on the charge of assaulting and murdering Miss Cassell Wilds.
So her name is Miss Cassell Wilds. Go ahead.
On her way home from Sunday school yesterday, when Godley was strung up, there was much shooting at the body.
When Godley was strung up, they shot his body up. They shot the brother's great 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 grandfather up. Go ahead. Oh, that's the uncle.
That's the uncle.
So that's French.
That's Will.
Oh, this is Will Godley here. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
And a boy was killed and several persons wounded by the indiscriminate firing.
Go ahead.
Esau was probably drunk.
Oh, you know they were drinking, probably friggin' doing all kinds of filth, man. Esau's most damn profane.
That's right. Just before his death, Carter confessed that the real culprit was Joe Clark, a Pullman car porter, and a mob was arranged to meet him when he returns from his run and lynched him.
Go ahead.
The feeling against
him. So in other words, they lynched the wrong man.
That's right.
As always.
Yeah.
It always comes out later on, oh, that was the wrong man, but so what? He's a nigger anyway.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. It doesn't matter. And nobody's paid for these crimes.
No, right. Nobody.
This is one instance right here, but this happened all over America.
Right.
Go ahead.
The feeling against the Negroes is intense, and 25 armed men
are now raiding the colored quarters. Doing what?
Oh, excuse me. Shooting at every black they can find.
See that? The white man is the damn devil, man.
That's what the Bible speaks of.
He is the devil the Bible speaks of. So you're guilty just by being black in this country, man. You're already guilty. He's already passed judgment on you, man. Mm-hmm. Good.
The murder of Miss Wilds was most atrocious. She was met near.
Go down here.
Oh, okay.
Read the next. Now, this is the next day.
Next day.
Same paper.
Right. Pierce City, Missouri, August 20th. With the exception of a few car porters who are known to be respectable.
Because the car porters were all the brothers. That's one of the jobs the brothers was allowed to have back in those days. You couldn't do much, but they gave you that job. Hey, go be a porter, nigga. Go do that. Go ahead.
Carry my bags.
Carry my bags, nigga.
There is not a Negro in this town. For 15 hours, an armed and furious mob coursed through the streets, chasing away every Negro.
So the white man began terrorizing every Negro he saw after the death of this white woman, Cassell Wilds. Go ahead.
The homes of five Negroes were burned.
The homes of five Negroes were burned. Remember, the article just said there's no Negroes in that town besides the Porters.
That's right.
That's the only people that was working in there. The only brothers and families that was working in there were Porters.
Here's a question. They've already lynched a brother for this murder.
Yes.
They said he wasn't guilty for the murder. They know who did the murder. So why are they burning everybody else's house?
Because they are the devil, the Bible says.
That's right.
That's right.
They are the devil. Listen, man, you Negroes going to keep getting shot down in America until you realize that fact, man.
That's right.
Until you separate from this devil, this beast, man.
That's right.
You think he's a man. He's not a damn man. He's an animal.
That's it.
This man is an animal, point blank, period. He ain't got no conscience. He ain't got no empathy for you and what you've been through at all.
At all.
He is an animal, man. A human being is supposed to have empathy for another human being. Mm. He ain't got no empathy but for his damn self, man. Mm. Read on.
The homes of five Negroes were burned. And in one of them, Peter Hampton, age 71 and feeble, was cremated.
Huh. What does that mean? They burned the brother alive, 71 years old. And who? They said 71 and what?
Excuse me, 71 and feeble.
71 and feeble. So he could barely get around. They set this brother on fire and cremated him, man.
As he was unable to escape.
Go ahead, man.
Beginning Sunday afternoon, when the mangled remains of Miss Gazelle Wild were discovered in a ravine, where she had been murdered while struggling with a Negro assailant.
Now, they say it was a Negro assailant. Who saw that it was a Negro assailant? Another damn devil.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
This community has been in a terrible fever. Yesterday, Will Godley, a suspect, was arrested.
Yesterday, Will Godley, the brother's...
Great uncle.
That's the uncle right there. Mm-hmm. Will Godley was arrested. Go ahead.
Excuse me. A suspect was arrested, and last night he was lynched.
Now, Will Godley was lynched, but they already lynched another man for that crime. Mm-hmm. White man is the devil the Bible speaks of, man.
And you know what? They hate this history.
Right. Yeah, they hate this history.
Oh, they hate this history.
They really do.
Hey, this is why a lot of these books are so pricey now.
Absolutely.
Because as this truth continues to grow in the earth and brothers start to gain wisdom and understanding and get these historical facts to prove that everything in the Bible is 100% true, because we have the historical records to prove it.
Mm-hmm.
So now these books are becoming super pricey. Go ahead, brother.
And let me say this. You know who hates this history the most? We do.
We do.
Yeah. Oh, we do. Yeah.
Good point.
I had one of my, a friend of mine on Facebook tell me that was 100 years ago. Forget about it.
Yeah,
and this was after Mike Brown got shot down in Missouri.
See that?
Oh, yeah. And Lynch.
This is that door pattern. Thank you, brother. It's that door pattern comes from what happened in these times right here in the early 1900s, man. You are terrorized into believing these things. Just let it go. Let it go. That is Willie Lynch, and that is fear, man. That is fear.
Let me say one more thing. I posted this on my Facebook page when I found the information out to shed light on the fact that nothing has changed in America,
right.
Specifically Missouri.
Right.
Nothing has changed.
Right.
If Mike Brown is dead in 2013, and you know my relatives died 100 and some odd years previously, mm-hmm. What is the difference?
Right.
There is no difference.
Thing. Still my relatives.
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you what the difference is. Right. Now you Negroes got you could be a being an athlete, now you could be a singer, so you think you're all good. Oh, we got iPhones and iPods and internet. That's all that's changed. And maybe a better car. I got AC now. What else has really changed?
Still being oppressed.
You're still paycheck to paycheck. You're still stuck in the ghettos of America.
Yeah.
Primarily.
That unconscious sleep just infuriates.
And to show you how serious that is, how deep that goes, the brother tells you to forget something 100 years ago.
Sister.
What does July 4th celebrate or commemorate?
Hmm.
But I guarantee she was at that barbecue.
Answer me that, sister.
That's a celebration of something that was so long ago.
Mm. That was 1776.
1776.
Right. Negro was in chains.
And America will not let you forget that because they allow you to celebrate it every single year.
That's right.
But when it comes to our history, Negro, just forget it. Wait a minute. Has anyone told the Jewish man to forget the Holocaust?
Not at all.
No.
The alleged
Holocaust. He has a memorial.
Right.
For his Holocaust.
And he gets paid billions of dollars for that so-called Holocaust.
1948 was a long time ago.
Yeah, yeah.
The Negro was still in Jim Crow, which is still a form of slavery back in until the late 60s.
Man.
So how you gonna forget that? How you gonna wanna forget that? But you wanna remember, you don't tell the fake Jew forget the Holocaust.
Right.
You don't tell America forget July 4th or forget Thanksgiving or forget 9/11 was damn near, 15 years ago now? Yeah. How come you ain't telling them to forget that?
They ain't never gonna forget that.
Esau said never forget.
Never forget.
Never.
Come on, man.
Hey. The so-called Jew has a monument not only here, but in every country.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's it.
Where he was.
Right.
So-called
right.
persecuted.
Hmm.
Right.
Go ahead.
His grandfather, French Godley, was shot to death.
So, this is the third man put to death now. First they put Eugene Carter to death. Then he put Will Godley to death. Now, the brother's grandfather to death. Read it again.
French Godley was shot to death.
French Godley, the brother's, the great uncle's grandfather was now put to death.
Right. Eugene Carter, alias Barrett, also a suspect, was strung up until he confessed.
See that? Until he confessed. So you gotta... This is man, it's ridiculous. It's the white man is the devil, the Bible speaks.
Let me add a little insight to this particular part too. I was reading the St. Louis paper because they have that on Google Images. You can Google Image it. They stood on two sides of French's house when they shot him to death. They were standing on the front and the right side shooting into that house. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just from the front. Mm-hmm. It was an ambush. And this was before they set it on fire.
Huh. So they shot up the house first, then set it on fire.
Right.
Wow. Wow. Let's get Habakkuk 2 and 4 real quick. I gotta go to Habakkuk 2 and 4 real quick.
It's the book of
man, oh man. Because I hope you brothers and sisters really wake up and do a little research, man. It's time to come out of the filth of America, man.
Right.
You gotta wake up or else you're gonna die in America. Point blank period.
This is the book of Habakkuk. Chapter 2 and verse 4. Behold, his soul which is lifted up.
Who's the he? The he is the white man. Mm-hmm. That's who the he is. The he is Esau, Edom, the white man, the so-called white man, which is really red. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Behold, his soul which is lifted up.
The Bible says this man's soul. Who created this man? The Most High God created this man. But you want to rehabilitate him. You want to be with him. You want to be like him. You want to be him. You can't be the so-called white man. All right? You can't be him. God made this man. And God is going to tell you about the soul of this man. Go ahead.
Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him.
God says. I didn't say it. The Bible said it. His soul ain't right.
That's right.
Right. Acquittal after acquittal after, you can't even get an indictment even on camera. And you think this man is upright and just when he's just been civilized? He's just started taking baths.
Right.
That's right.
Right.
That's but you right. want to follow him, be him. You want to be you want a man like Brad Pitt for the sisters did, and so forth. George Clooney. You think these men are so great? Come on, man. Bill Clinton. To hell with them. They're your slaves on the loose.
That's right.
Point blank, period.
Criminals.
And some of y'all scared of that thing.
Y'all, every last one of them need to be in jail, in chains, man. Read it again.
Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him.
God says, God said it. His soul ain't right.
Mm-hmm.
You can't rehabilitate this man. To murder at the level that this man is murdered at, his soul ain't right. And then forget it and cleanse him and basically sanctify himself through his propaganda and media. You gotta, y'all gotta wake up, man. Wake up. Mm-hmm. Finish that, officer.
But the just shall live by faith.
But the just shall live by faith. Let's go back to this, but I just have to get that script, man. Because the man is not right.
Hey, officer, before you get that script, can we jump over one chapter? Because you said about, you spoke about the indictments, right?
Yes.
I'll read this for you. It's the book of Habakkuk, chapter 1 and verse 4. Therefore, the law is slack.
Therefore what?
The law is slack.
Jump up a verse.
Uh-huh. That's verse 4. You want verse
3? Verse 3. Go to 3.
Why dost thou show me, excuse me, why dost thou shew me iniquity?
Why do you show me iniquity? Go ahead.
And cause me to behold grievance.
You cause us to behold grievance. Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
For spoiling and violence.
For what?
For spoiling and violence.
Because today you are spoiled. You are spoiled with what happened back in these times right here. Mm-hmm. You are spoiled. And what?
For spoiling and violence.
We are victims of spoiling, and we are victims of the violence that have been done to us. That's why the sister could say, oh, just forget about it. Forget about it. Right. Forget about it. Leave it alone. It was a long time ago. But what happened a long time ago is why you're stuck in your low conditions today.
That's right.
Go ahead.
Are before me.
And spoiling and violence are before me. Go ahead.
And there are that rise, and there are that raise up strife and contention.
They raise up strife and contention against you. He raped a white woman. Let's kill all of them.
Yeah. All of them. Yeah.
We don't want no niggers in this town here.
Right.
We don't want no niggers. The sun. Don't let the sun go down on you, nigga. Mm-hmm. And put it posted real big at the city limits.
Right.
All niggers out by sundown.
Esau was in such a frenzy, even tanned white people were in danger.
Yeah, I'm glad you said that. I'm glad you said that, because lo and behold, guess what? I've been doing a little research, and I have a book called Sundown Towns. Right here, I got this book called Sundown Towns by James W. Lowen. This is an Edomite, but he also has another great book called Lies My Teacher Told Me. I know you've heard of that. He wrote this book called Sundown Town, and he went all around, like you did with the census, he ran around documenting how all these towns became whitewashed. Because guess what we didn't know? The Chinese was also here in the late 1800s, spread out across America too. All right. But wait a minute, you only see the Chinese basically in Chinatowns. So how did the Chinatowns get created? Edomites did the same thing to the Chinese that they did to us. Like you said, even tan devils, right. they were getting it too.
Right.
You too, you're a little too dark. You've been in the sun too long. Oh, I'm putting you to death.
Right.
Okay, so this is how Chinatowns were created all across America. Mm-hmm. By Esau pushing them out of Wyoming, Montana, Nebraska, Arkansas,
yep.
Kansas. They were spread out just like we were spread out. Okay? And pushed them into Chinatowns today. So y'all gotta do some damn history, man.
Right.
Learn something for a change. Put down the damn reality TV shows. Put down the damn PlayStation,
right.
Okay? Because it ain't benefiting you nothing. All right, stop being a little boy and be a man.
Right.
Put down childish things, man. Come be a man and learn something. Finish that?
Can I get a script real quick?
Well, he ain't finished the script.
Oh, okay, good.
It's the book of Habakkuk, chapter 1 and verse 4, continuing. Therefore,
now, because of the spoiling and the violence, mm-hmm.
Therefore the law is slack.
Because of the spoiling and the violence, judgment doesn't go forth for us. The law is slack when it concerns you Negroes and Hispanics.
That's right.
That's why you get shot up today, just like the brother, the family's getting shot up in this book here in the early 1900s. Nobody paid for that crime. Nobody went to jail. Okay? Matter of fact, they break in the jail and take you out of the jail.
That's right.
And let you either in the city square or where was that? At the hotel. The
hotel on the porch.
Yeah. How you get lynched at the damn hotel, man?
Yeah.
No one goes to jail. These men aren't masked. Remember, when they lynch somebody, it's a big deal. It's an event.
Right.
The whole city knows.
That's what a picnic is.
Excuse me.
There you go.
Not even the whole city, the damn state, because people come from all over the damn country. Sometimes there's 5,000 people at a time watching you burn.
Right, right.
Watching them cut off your genitals,
right.
Or your ears.
You
see that in pictorials and that without a sanctuary.
And it's in,
sanctuary.
It's in this book I got right here, Without Sanctuary.
And officer,
they made postcards out of
it,
you.
That's it.
Oh, this is how we did this nigger here.
That's it. And they actually sold them at grocery stores. Like, it was for sale.
Matter of fact, W.E.B. Du Bois, when he came to Atlanta, he saw the brothers, I believe it was George Ward. He saw George Ward's knuckles in a storefront to be sold. The brothers, it terrorized him. I think that was like one of his first times in Atlanta. He walking down the street, as in one of my books. He walking down the street, he seeing a brother, he knew a brother just got lynched, I think it was months ago. The brother's knuckles was in the damn storefront, just chilling, waiting to be sold by your damn enemy.
And you know what, they like those mementos of our oppression, of our slaughter. They like those things, because that's why they keep those figurines of the mammy.
The mammies.
Oh, yes. Man.
Figurines of the gator baits. Yeah. They like those things because it makes them reminisce to a time when they were able to slaughter us in the middle of the street.
Right. Trophies.
There's trophies.
Like, yeah, like a predator.
Exactly. Right. Exactly. So they'll say things like, oh, this Atlanta's not like how it used to be. They right. say things like that, meaning there's too many dark faces in this exactly. area now. Before, we could have killed y'all, bombed y'all, and threw y'all out.
Yeah.
Right.
But now we got to be politically correct. Exactly. Let me go and look at my figurine.
Right. Go ahead, officer.
Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 4. Therefore the law is slack, and judgment doth never go forth.
That's why you get acquittal after acquittal, even if you get killed on camera. Right. It's acquittal after acquittal. Go ahead.
For the wicked doth compass about the righteous.
The wicked compass about the righteous. You are that righteous seed.
That's right.
But guess what? The wicked seed compasses about you. Now they terrorizing you as the police.
That's right.
Go ahead.
Therefore, wrong judgment proceedeth.
Therefore what?
Wrong judgment proceedeth.
You hear what the Bible says? So we know the prophecies in this Bible, man.
That's right.
We know in this land of our captivity, we cannot get justice. Because what would justice really be on this land for the Negro? That means every white man has to go.
That's right.
They have to go into chains. That's what justice is. So him giving you a little 40 acres and a mule, which would be great for, that would be a great start, even though in our destroyed state, we'd find a way to give it all back to Esau anyway.
Right.
Okay?
Hey, we'll take that mule and put 20s on him.
Right. Yeah, we're going hey, we're gonna put 20 spinners on the mule. You know what I'm saying? Esau gave me this mule, man. I'm gonna pimp him out.
Yeah, I'm gonna pimp that mule out.
Hey, I'm gonna put the diamond, the rhinestones and the diamonds on my saddle. You know? Hey, I'm gonna have mine with a blonde weave. You know what I'm saying?
Oh,
that's weird.
Yeah. And they'll do it too.
Yo, Jake in our destroyed state will do it, man.
Because I don't want my mule to look like yours, so I'm gonna trick it out.
Yeah, I'm gonna trick my mule out, you know what I'm saying? Have it sitting on Vogue's and all that.
Judah. You know, sometimes when I'm out and about, man, some people might, you know, question me about what it is, who I am, and what I believe in. You know, I like to get a little methodical sometimes, so I may give them an answer like this. Check this out. From the air I breathe to the blood I bleed, I won't respect my temple and do it proudly. Ask about my race, my nationality, I won't hesitate. That's cause I don't doubt it. I'm from Judah, Judah. Judah,
what tribe?
Yeah,
you from?
I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
What tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
I said, what tribe?
Yeah,
you
from? I'm from Judah. Judah. To all my brothers and sisters, it's that time for repentance. Look at our pain and our struggles. Don't let this devil die in you. He gave me laws I'm gonna keep. I suggest you do similar. Got the kingdom before us. He sent his son to come heal us. Now all that loud talking, that moonwalking, that shucky jiving, doing nothing. Run around like I'm doing something. Most y'all ain't here fronting. Got a problem with me, cause I know how to read. And I ain't falling behind these dummies. All off in them pockets. Yes, he passed about his money. Truth come out and y'all running. Super Christian turned athlete. Track star, he gunning. Hate the fact we up in these streets. Don't teach the people that won't it.
Now fix your face. We ain't going nowhere, homie. This is fact, not fiction. We gon' teach it as it's written, like my forefathers before me. This is why my spirit was given. I ain't with it, I ain't with it. If you ain't coming with scriptures, let my father paint the perfect picture, mister. This is how I'm feeling. From the air I breathe to the blood I bleed, I'm gonna respect my temple and do it proudly. Ask about my race, my nationality, I won't hesitate. That's cause I don't doubt it. I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
What tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
What tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
I said, what tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah.
T into the A-H. Y'all can keep them lies of what them imposters say. A, cause our Lord and Savior Christ holds the crown. I don't know what y'all been told, but Judah black unto the crown. And the spirit bears witness with our spirit that we the sons of God. So fix your lips and pay attention. Listen to them scriptures exactly as it's written. But y'all drunk with wine, and I ain't talking that fermented. So enough with all that heckling. We speak with all authority. What the hell was y'all expecting? That's all talky, feminine walk. Hell, nah, that ain't how we step in. Don't cry aloud, and we don't care if you offended. Yeah, we with it, yeah, we with it. See, the truth is what we spitting to the ones that wanna hear it. And if not, then we dismissing. Cause you know we on a mission. So I ain't gon' hide the fact that I'm from
Judah.
Pay attention.
From the air I breathe to the blood I bleed, I'm gonna respect my temple and do it proudly. Ask about my race, my nationality, I won't hesitate. That's cause I don't doubt it. I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
What tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
What tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
I said, what tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah.
Judah, I'm from that tribe that the Most High sent his son to. And I'm waiting for the kingdom to come. And when it does, ain't no word that the meeting gonna run to. Cause I got a couple things I'ma bring to the table that I've read so many times. Psalms 137:9. Esau, this means your ass is mine. And that'll be the day that I've been waiting on patience. Judah rose up, then the rest of y'all jumped like a standing ovation. Everybody looking with their face all flipped. Even though they say they know that Christ ain't white. Trying to tell our people that they really the Jews. Like trying to tell the moon that the sun ain't bright.
What?
From the breath I breathe to the blood I bleed. My nationality is Israel. But one more thing, J-U-D-A-H. My tribe is J-U-D-A-H. And I can barely wait until I get to see they face. Cause we gon' give them trouble. Sparks across the stubble. Everything them heathen did to us, they gon' get double. Dashed across stones, valley bones no longer dry. No weapon formed against us, we no longer die. Yeah.
From the air I breathe to the blood I bleed, I'm gonna respect my temple and do it proudly. Ask about my race, my nationality, I won't hesitate. That's cause I don't doubt it. I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
What tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
What tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
I said, what tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah.
That's
cause I don't doubt it. I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
What tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
What tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah, Judah, Judah.
I said, what tribe?
Yeah, I'm from Judah.
Oh, but hey, finish that one. Finish that.
That was it.
You have something? So we're gonna go back to the book. Yeah, let's go back to the story now.
It says, go back a little bit up. It says his grandfather, French Godly, was shot to death. Eugene Carter, alias Barrett, also a suspect, was strung up until he confessed.
Okay, and, so he confessed and under distress.
Right, under distress.
Go ahead.
Right, and may die of his injuries.
Okay.
A boy was fatally injured by a stray bullet during the raid upon the Negro quarters.
So, in other words, they just shooting in the air. They're just shooting randomly in the air as a mob to terrorize the Negroes. And guess what? A little boy got shot. Go ahead.
Last night. And the mob is thirsting to get its hands upon two other Negroes. suspected for complicity in the murder.
Hey, this is like today. Let's put this to today now. A Negro commits a crime in the ghetto. Every last one of you are a suspect.
That's right.
Whether you got a suit and tie on, whether you got your pants below your behind, whether you're fat, whether you're skinny, whether you got a beard, whether you don't. Every last one of you are a suspect.
I'm glad you just brought that up. There's a video that I saw the day before yesterday of that brother that was beaten up in the grocery store in New York. Did y'all see that?
Mm-mm.
When he had his hands up and the cop...
Oh, yes.
Him in
the
white cop comes over and starts punching him in the face because he allegedly stole a slice of pizza.
How do you steal a slice of pizza?
How do you even do that? How do you even do that?
Boy.
And then come to find out, he was actually innocent. It wasn't him.
Wow.
But guess what? You fit the description. You're dark and you're male. That's the description.
That's
right.
It.
So the dude is in the store actually just purchasing something. He's at the counter and it just so happened. And this goes to show, now we're in the age of technology.
Right.
So a lot of things are being filmed and it's being brought to your doorstep now because you have no choice. Someone filmed it and it's all over social media. It's all over the news. So now we're in shock. I can't believe this is 2015. Negro, this has been happening since the 1400s.
Huh. Right. Wake up.
Since the 1400s. Now, the only thing is, the stupor that you like to remain in has now, it's been forced to your doorstep. You have no choice but to see it now. You cannot say, oh, we're not getting gunned down in America by whites, because guess what? Dylann Roof went into the church and showed you that you're still getting gunned down by whites.
That's
and you
right.
have no, you have no say-so in or visualize or seeing that.
Wow.
Because they brought it to your doorstep.
Officer, the Most High showed our people something even like. He gave him a break.
You got
punched for pizza.
Bro.
That should still wake you up.
Bro.
You got punched for pizza.
The dude, went,
damn,
he's standing at the counter. He's standing at the counter. The officer walks up to him,
mm-hmm.
like shoves him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he turns around and notices the kid. He's like, he puts his hand like, you know, what's going on? You there's no audio, but you can see by his gestures. He has his hands up. He's like basically saying, I didn't do anything,
mm-hmm.
right? He's having the first officer's like shoving at him. And he has that baton in his hand.
Okay.
He's shoving at him. All of a sudden, out of nowhere, this big gorilla Edomite, so-called white man, comes over and starts punching him in the face. His hands are up. Well, is that foreign? No. Wasn't Mike Brown's autopsy said his hands were up when he was shot?
Same thing.
Yes, that's right.
So this is something that's not foreign to our people. It's actually very common. The only difference is now it's being brought to you because it's being recorded, it's being videotaped, and it's being brought to the social medias. That's the only difference. It's been going on. For those who come from inner cities, police harassment, police brutality is something as common as chicken and beer.
Right. Hey, that's the way you got it. That's
right.
It's as common as chicken and beer.
Right.
I remember things like that as early as like middle school of friends of mine and myself being harassed by police and thrown
right.
down and searched
right.
and being roughed up for no reason. We're shooting basketball in a park. What could we possibly be doing?
Right.
Let me calm down. Die of his injuries.
Jump up here.
Okay. After the lynching of Godley last night, it was thought the excitement would die down.
So but, after Godley got lynched, everybody thought, okay, it's going to die down. Go ahead.
But instead, it became more intense.
Oh, man. Now it's getting more intense. We lynched these three Negroes. We killed them, shot their bodies up. Now we want blood. We want more blood. Go ahead.
In as much as the impression grew that Godley was not the real culprit.
Whoa. Read that again, brother. Read it again.
In as much as the impression grew that Godley was not the real culprit.
The white man always suddenly remembers, oh man, maybe we got the wrong guy.
Mm-hmm.
I guess we gotta go lynch more Negroes.
Right.
So we find the guy. Go ahead.
Early this morning, the mob broke into the arsenal of the local militia company.
You saw this in a movie called Rosewood.
Mm-hmm.
You saw this in Rosewood. They break into the local militia, the gun shop. Go ahead.
Secured the rifles and ammunition.
They armed themselves.
And started out to clear Pierce City of all Negroes.
And did what?
Started out to clear Pierce City of all Negroes.
And guess what? If you go Google Pierce City today, And you go find out how many Negroes today live in Pierce City. Not a near one. Negroes don't live in Pierce City. And guess what? Pierce City is not, that is not just that city in America. There's cities all over with the same situation.
That's right.
Negroes don't live there for a reason. Read on.
The work was thoroughly done.
The work was thoroughly done. Not a near Negro in this town. We're going to burn your houses down. And if we find you, we're going to put you to death. It's called ethnic cleansing.
That's right.
Go ahead.
The terrified blacks, bullets whistling about their ears, and in some instances, finding lodgment in their bodies.
You hear that? So as they're leaving, they're getting shot. Go ahead.
Fled to the woods and nearby towns.
So they fled to the nearby towns. Go ahead.
Where they are being hidden by friends.
Go ahead.
Damn. Let me keep reading. This afternoon, partial quiet was restored. But this fact is due to the lack of Negroes to shoot upon.
Yeah. Hey, it's peaceful now. We ain't got no more niggas to kill and shoot at. So hold that, officer. I want you to get this book now. Like I said, this is called Sundown Towns. I want you to read that highlight right here on page 4.
This is the book Sundown Towns by James W. Lowen, page 4. The highlight says, beginning in about 1890 and continue until 1968.
1890.
And continuing until 1968.
So this is during the Jim Crow era.
Right. White Americans.
Your friendly neighborhood Christian white man.
Established thousands of towns across the United States for whites only.
You hear that? They established these white towns during this time period. This is after the Reconstruction period. Okay? After physical slavery. And the black man started to rise during the Reconstruction era when he was a Republican. Okay? Y'all probably don't know that though. Y'all think we were just all Democrats because. No, the Democrats hated your guts and still hate your guts today. Okay? Go ahead.
Many towns drove out their black populations, then posted.
Don't let darkness hit you in Hawthorne, California. Those are what they posted at their city limits. They posted sundown signs. Go ahead.
Other towns passed ordinances barring African Americans after dark.
Doing what?
Barring African Americans after dark.
So they barred you from these towns after dark. Okay? You could not dwell here.
And during that time in 1890 also were the Black Code laws.
Yes.
Which many Negroes across America was not allowed to be outside after dark.
That's right. Or you're getting locked up, you're going to jail.
So yeah. Many of our brothers and sisters, you couldn't pass through that town, nor could you actually be outside in your own town after dark.
Right. Hmm. Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah, you got curfew.
Right.
Go ahead.
Prohibiting them from owning or renting property.
So in these towns, these sundown towns, they passed laws against you. In other words, policies against you from owning or renting property in these towns. Go ahead.
Still, others established such policies by informal means, harassing, and even killing those who violated the rules.
You hear that? I catch you over here, you getting strung up. You're gonna be hanging from that damn lamppost by sundown, man. If you still here, go back to the book. This is how these towns were created, man. This is how today ghettos were created. Today,
that's right. Back to
100 years of lynching.
Page 43 says, early this morning, the mob broke into the arsenal of the local militia company. Secured rifles and ammunition and started to clear out Pierce City of all Negroes. The work was thoroughly done. The terrified blacks, bullets This afternoon, partial quiet was restored.
Uh-huh.
But this fact is due to the lack of Negroes to shoot upon.
Citizens mindful of several hideous crimes against women hear about in recent years have decreed that no Negro can hereafter live in Pierce City.
Yeah, that.
Or pass through.
You can't even pass through here.
Dang.
We don't even want you. We don't want your kind around here. Mm-hmm. Ain't that what the white man says? We don't want your kind around here.
We don't cater to your kind.
We don't cater to your kind. We want your money around here. You can't stay in my restaurant. Nigga, what you doing?
Five pounds.
Go ahead, officer.
The place on pain of death. This may necessitate a complete change in the car porter system of four railroads centering near here.
Go ahead. So the Negro wasn't allowed to be a car porter then, for the train system, right? He wasn't allowed to have that job no more. Those are going to white men. Go ahead.
New elements in the murder of Miss Wild developed today. It appears she started home from church alone, her brother lingering behind. About 1 mile from town, the brother found her with her throat cut, lying lifeless near her culvert, under which her assailant had attempted to drag her. Evidence of a terrible struggle was shown. A copper.
That's all I want. Let's go to Jen.
Let's hear the.
Good.
A copper colored Negro was seen sitting on the bridge a short time before the tragedy occurred.
A copper colored Negro. That could be anybody.
This is why they lynched multiple brothers. Because the description they give is so vague, it could be anybody.
Could be anybody, also.
A copper-colored Negro.
Let's go to Genesis 27. Because one thing we got to remember, what did the Most High say? Okay? Most High said this man is a beast. Right. His soul is not upright. But now, let's see, what is the blessing of Esau? Okay? Are we going to have our own land and prosper in the land with Esau? No, the Most High did not set us up here to prosper in that way. We are supposed to repent. That's why we're here, to repent.
Right. This is the book of Genesis, chapter 27, and start at 38. And Esau said unto his father, "Hast thou but one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, O my father."
So this is Esau. Esau's coming to Isaac after Jacob got the blessing. Coming as Esau, because we know the scripture says in Romans 9, okay, the lecture was to Jacob, not Esau. Right. So now Esau is coming after Jacob got the blessing. Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
And Esau lifted up his voice and wept.
Now he wept after he already gave away his birthright. Let's not forget that part. He gave it away. Go ahead.
And Isaac his father answered and said unto him, "Behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth."
What's Esau's blessing?
Thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth.
Yeah, what the blessing is? Esau is blessed with being able to live on the fatness of the earth, the best part. That's why he's able to drive nations off of lands and dwell in them. And then pretend to be them.
Right. Yeah.
He's not the original Greek. Right. He's not the original Anglo-Saxon.
Right. Is he the last samurai?
He's nowhere near the last samurai. He's not the Mexican. He's not the last samurai. He ain't Christ.
In the movie Exodus.
And he's not the Jew either.
Is in the movie Exodus, they also Egyptians?
Yeah. Egyptians. He's everywhere. Yeah, and he's not Egyptian either.
He's everywhere.
He's everywhere and everyone.
So this man's blessing is to be able to live on the land, the best of the land. Right. Drive you off of your land.
Right.
Okay? He's done that throughout his being on this earth. That was the man's blessing, man.
That's right.
So let's find out a little more. I want you to read this here. Read down that. So now, during Jim Crow, we're going to read about some American policies of what the white man, with his blessing of owning your land, how did he create these ghettos? Good. How did he further create these ghettos, I'll say? Good.
On using the word ghetto, one of the ways in which we forget our history is by sanitizing our language.
So cleansing our language, cleaning it up. Well, it's not really ghetto. We're going to call it urban.
Right,
go ahead.
Right, right. And pretending that these problems don't exist.
We're going to pretend these problems don't exist, that we pushed all these Negroes into ghettos. Like what happened then when something like Freddie Gray happens in Baltimore, then everybody's like, why do Negroes like this?
Right.
Why do they act like this? Right. Why they got to tear everything up?
Right.
Go ahead.
We have always recognized that these were ghettos.
Go ahead.
A ghetto is, as I define it, a neighborhood which is homogenous and from which there are serious barriers to exist. That is the technical definition of ghetto.
Go ahead.
Robert Weaver, the first African-American member of the cabinet appointed by President Johnson.
Lyndon B. Johnson, with his New Deal.
As his Secretary of Housing and Urban Development.
Go ahead.
Described many of the policies that I've described today in a book he published in 1948 called The Negro Ghetto.
Go ahead. So he wrote a book. He was on the cabinet of Lyndon B. Johnson. Go ahead.
In 1948. The Kerner Commission referred to the ghetto. This is the term that we no longer use because we're embarrassed to talk about it. And we need to comfort our history.
We need to what?
Confront our history.
No.
It says confront.
Oh, okay. Confront our history.
And stop sanitizing our language and talk openly about what we've done as a nation.
So let's find out, what has America done to the Negro as a nation? Read on.
And what we need to do to undo it.
Uh-huh.
And we can't talk openly if we're going to use euphemisms instead of being explicit about what the reality is.
So in other words, we can't do anything about it if we're going to keep lying to each other.
Right.
Go ahead.
Right. On how the New Deal's Public Works Administration led to the creation of segregated ghettos.
So now we're gonna read about one of the policies of Lyndon B. Johnson's New Deal to create ghettos.
Right.
Go ahead.
Its policy was that public housing could be used only to house people of the same race.
Damn. What wasn't this the man that supposedly did the civil rights deal with Martin Luther King? Mm-hmm. Lyndon B. Johnson. Mm-hmm. Huh. But Lyndon B. Johnson also said, I'm going to have these niggers voting Democratic for the next 200 years.
Damn.
Now you're all Democratic. That's why you're all stuck in the ghettos, man. Mm. Go ahead.
I got to read that at the top. Mm.
Read it from the top, officer.
Its policy was that the public housing could be used only to house people of the same race.
Go ahead.
As the neighborhood in which it was located.
Go ahead.
But in fact, most of the public housing that was built in the early years was built in integrated neighborhoods.
Now listen closely. Most of the public housing projects, mm-hmm. quote unquote projects, were built in integrated neighborhoods. Let's find out why they were built in integrated neighborhoods. Go ahead.
Which they raised and then built segregated public housing in those neighborhoods.
So they built the segregated, okay, we're gonna put the niggas here. Go ahead.
So public housing created racial segregation.
So now you as a white man in your town.
Let me read this last part.
Go ahead.
Where
none existed before. So you as a white man in your town, now in your town, and it's a white town, they build segregated housing and put all the Negroes beside you. What do you think as a white man, what do you think a white man is going to do? There goes the neighborhood. It's time to go.
Right.
The niggas are coming. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
That was one of the chief policies.
That was one of the main policies.
On the Federal Housing Administration's overtly racist policies in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s.
Overtly racist.
Meaning everybody knew it was racist.
Right.
Overtly racist. So everybody knew. This is some racist nonsense going on here. Go ahead.
The second policy, which was probably even more effective in the segregation metropolitan areas, was the Federal Housing Administration, which financed mass production builders of subdivisions starting in the 30s and then going into the 40s and the 50s, in which those mass production builders placed like Levittown, New York, for example.
Levittown, New York was one of those.
And Nassau County, New York.
Nassau County, that's Long Island.
And in every metropolitan area in the country.
So all in the big cities of America, they start building these segregated housing projects. Cabrini Green, in South Central LA, Brooklyn, New York, Bronx, New York, Baltimore, Atlanta. Where they have Bankhead houses and all that. Bowen Homes and all of that.
Little Haiti down in Miami.
These were all built in this time period. Projects. Yeah. LES. All of that.
Oh, yeah. Little East.
Go ahead.
The Federal Housing Administration gave builders like Levitt concessionary loans.
They gave concessionary loans to these builders.
Through banks because they guaranteed loans at a lower interest
they
rate.
They guaranteed the loans at a lower interest. We could build these things cheap. Go ahead.
For banks that the developers could use to build the subdivisions on the condition that no homes in the subdivisions be sold to African Americans.
No homes in the subdivision be sold to African Americans. Go ahead.
It says, in the ghettos, government policies, municipal policy, for example, denied adequate services.
They denied adequate services. What's adequate services? The trash being that's picked it. Up twice a week and so forth.
Right.
Your amenities. Right. Go ahead.
Garbage wasn't collected frequently.
Garbage was not collected. So the ghetto looks like hell on earth.
Right.
You got trash everywhere. But in the white neighborhood, oh, it's nice and clean. White folks are dirty as all hell.
Right.
So how is their neighborhood so clean, all so damn dirty?
It's by design.
It's by design.
You bringing it out today, officer.
Wow.
All praises, Musa.
Hey, all praises, man.
African Americans were crowded into neighborhoods.
So we were crowded into neighborhoods, projects, on top of each other. That's why we kill each other, because we ain't got no damn space.
Right.
You know how easy it is for a young black man to get in trouble in the ghetto? Hmm. You just walk outside and bump the next brother the wrong way by mistake, or you step on his shoe, you might lose your life.
Right.
That's fact. Why? Because we're all bunched up on together like damn animals, man.
Yeah, because we're a product of that design.
We're a product of the design. Go ahead.
Let me read that again. African Americans were crowded into neighborhoods in the ghetto because so much other housing was closed to them.
See that? Your condition, brothers and sisters, is not by accident. It's by design.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. All these policies we're reading about back in the 30s and 40s and the 50s, going back to the 1900s, when they forced you out of your dwellings in Omaha, Montana, Nebraska, and so forth. Now you're pushed into big inner city ghettos.
That's right.
Go ahead.
Housing prices in the ghettos were much higher than similar housing in white now, areas.
Now, if you don't see the white man's the devil after you hear this, you a damn coon.
You a cup of coon.
You a coon and a half.
You a coon squared.
Yeah, you a coon to the third power, man. Alright, read that again, officer.
Let me read that again. It says, housing in the ghettos were much more higher than similar housing in white areas.
Now look at that there. You're in the ghetto on top of each other, garbage all over the damn place, rats all over the damn place, and you're paying more rent than in the white neighborhood.
That's right.
Wow.
That is, oh man, that's crazy. That's oppression, brothers.
Oh, yeah.
That is oppression. Hold that.
Isaiah
30 and 12. Because a lot of you brothers, a lot of you sisters, you love the ghetto you come from. You love the pro. Yo, I'm from Brownsville Projects, B. I'm from Gun Hill Projects.
Marcy, son.
I'm from Corporal Cologne, Marcy, son. You know?
Oh, man.
Yo, y'all love these projects that you're putting, man. Mm-hmm. But guess what? You were forced in those projects. Your forefathers before. Some of you are four generations in the projects.
Yep.
Five generations, six generations. That's nothing to be proud of, man. That's nothing to be proud of when you're in high school and you go to school and all of y'all are from Pelham Projects or Gun Hill Project or wherever you're from. And you repping that project, you see the next brother in another project, and you hate his guts. You wanna y'all having big brawls after school. You're in the same damn condition, man.
But they make you feel as if you're not.
Yeah, exactly. You're separate from the niggas is from Burke Ave over there. Oh, I don't like the niggas. That ain't the same damn ghetto you in. Why don't you go take your anger out on the real enemy that put you and your forefathers in the situation?
That's right.
No, you never do that.
Never.
No. I'm just going to look at the next black man who ain't got a damn thing, and I'm going to make him my enemy.
Hey, officer, Mr. Finkelstein is okay.
Yeah. Finkelstein is okay. Yeah.
You know what's funny? You know those case studies where they put a mouse in a maze to find his way to the cheese at the end or to find his way out? The mouse doesn't know he's in a maze. The mouse just thinks he's in another place that he needs to get out of. They don't view it as a maze. The same way we're designed in these places, we never take a step back and look out of that design.
That's very heavy.
We don't look out of that design. We just stay in the design and continually run through the maze and never stop and turn around. Sometimes we teach at camp, we tell our people, just turn around and look at your people. We never do that because we're so busy in the hustle and bustle. We're just going with the flow.
Right.
Never stopping and stepping back and saying, damn, why am I? I'm in the same rat race every day. And we never take the time to look at the design. So what the office is bringing out today is super heavy. It's forcing our people to look at the design that we're in. It is not by accident. This makeup is not by accident. It's called projects for a reason. It was a project designed for you so-called Negroes, Hispanics, and Native Americans. Okay?
Now that you say that, officer, it's eerily similar to that slave ship, how we were packed on that.
Exactly.
That's a good point.
How did they design it? Whereas we can fit a certain amount, if we lay them a certain way, no elbow room. It was designed that way.
So, brother,
what you brought out is heavy. It was, the design began before we even got here.
That's a heavy point. That's a heavy point. Good, officer. You want to get a script?
Isaiah
30 and 12.
Okay. This is the book of Isaiah chapter 30 and verse 12. Wherefore, thus saith the Holy One of Israel.
Let's see what the Most High God has said to us.
Because ye despise this word and trust in oppression.
Because you blacks and Hispanics despise God's words, man. That's why we're stuck in our condition and still stuck in our condition today. We despise God's words. We give you what God says, you hate our guts. But you don't really hate us, you hate God.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So you're gonna stay stuck in your oppression. Go ahead.
And trust in oppression.
What do our people do?
And trust in oppression.
So you trust and you're proud to be from these projects. Yo, y'all grew up in Marcy, son. Y'all grew up here. I grew up there. Yeah, these my projects right here. Yo, you can't walk through here, man. Yo, what you doing here? What color you got on? Why you rocking that color? Who you? Who you here to see? You know what I'm saying? You hear that all day, you know, when you walk into a project. Yo, who you here for? What the hell is this, man? Yo, yeah, we rep this project over here.
We rep on
the south side over here.
Red, blue, we rep.
Yeah.
Purple, pink.
You trust green. In oppression and you're proud of that oppression, man. You're proud of that. That's oppression. Don't be proud to live in no damn ghetto when you ducking bullets. Read on.
And trust in oppression and perverseness.
And you trust in perverseness. You trust in selling drugs to each other.
That's right.
You trust in murdering each other in those projects. You trust in that thing. Read on.
And stay thereon.
And what?
And stay thereon.
And you stay in your condition and you stay on the perverse and oppression. That's why, like I said, that's why you're four or five generations in the damn projects. All of us. Four or five generations. Projects after projects after projects. Generation after generation, grandmama was in the. What's wrong with that? Grandmama, she come from the projects too.
Right.
Great grandmama, she come from this project over here. Then we moved to these projects over here. We got the Section 8 voucher and came to these projects over here. Mm-hmm. Wake up, man. Go back to that. Finish that off. You got something? Oh.
I had something real quick. Now, also, we can't speak about the other side of that fence because these are. Remember, they said that the housing was more expensive in the ghettos, right? So there were some of our people who were able to, you didn't have to live in a project, but you bought a house in that ghetto. So you start to feel a little uppity.
Huh.
Can't forget about the uppity Negro.
Here come the Willie Lynch.
I was able to buy my own house. I wasn't forced into no projects. You decide to sit on your butt with welfare. They talk about our people.
Yes, can't forget those.
Let's go to Psalm 73.
That's a good point.
Psalm 73 and start at verse 7.
Alright. It's the book of Psalms, chapter 73 and verse 7. Uh-huh. And it says, their eyes stand out with fatness.
Why do their eyes stand out with fatness? Because they're doing well for themselves. They're doing well for themselves. So what they have, you know, great jobs. They have these good jobs. They have award certain benefits. These are the things that they have. Hold on one second, Ezra. Read that again for me, bro.
Mm-hmm. It's the book of Psalms 73 and 7. Their eyes stand out with fatness.
Because guess what? The fatness is talking about the goodly things. They have money. They have, so to speak, they're living above the poverty line. Mm-hmm. Okay? Read.
They have more than heart could wish.
So these are people that have the money to buy those houses. But guess what? During this time, America didn't allow you to buy a house anywhere you wanted. So they were still subject to the ghettos, but now they have the nice house in the ghetto. You understand? Now they have the nice house in the ghetto, so they feel uppity. Mm. Come on.
They are corrupt.
What are these people?
They are corrupt.
Let's see why.
And speak wickedly concerning oppression.
Read.
They speak loftily.
You understand? So because they have the means to buy that property, now they speak wickedly concerning oppression. You're in that condition because you don't want to work.
Yeah.
So the brother's like, I go to work every day, but I can't seem to make ends meet. How is that? Yeah, you didn't get an education. Well, I did go to school. Mm-hmm. I was able to afford college, but I graduated high school. I just got a job. They won't hire me anywhere else. All I could be is a porter on a damn train.
Hey, we got brothers in our congregation with master's degrees. Exactly. Still can't get a job.
Read verse 8 again.
Mm-hmm. They are corrupt.
These people are corrupt when you speak against your people that's in this design. Your job is to tell them how to get out of that design, how to get out of those ghettos, how to get out of those slums, how to, most importantly, get your mind out of the ghetto, get your mind out of the slum, get your spirit out of them things, come into the spirit of the Lord. Read.
And speak wickedly concerning oppression.
These type of people speak wickedly concerning oppression. Jesse Jackson speaks wickedly concerning oppression. Al Sharpton speaks wickedly concerning oppression because they make you feel like it's your fault that you're in those situations.
Hmm.
When we're reading the historical facts that these things are by design.
That's right.
One more scripture.
Come on.
Okay.
Let's go to Sirach 12.
Mm-hmm.
Let's prove. I believe it's verse 13. I want you to read verse 10 and then jump to verse 17.
All right. This is the book of Ecclesiasticus in the Apocrypha, chapter 12 and verse 10. Never trust thine enemy, for like as iron rusteth, so is his wickedness.
So as iron rusteth, so is his wickedness. This man, no matter if he's young or old, the Bible says your enemy is wicked as hell.
That's right.
Jump to verse 17.
Verse 17. If adversity come upon thee.
Read that again.
If adversity come upon thee.
So living shoulder to shoulder in these harsh conditions, in these cramped quarters, where you feel like if you don't get out and get some air, you won't kill somebody. In these projects, in these tenement houses, in these row homes. Read.
If adversity come upon thee.
Because these areas are filled with a certain a group of people. Who are the Israelites?
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Thou shalt find him there first.
So when these adversities, when we come out with, we read this, the history on these designs, these projects that were set in place. Who's at the helm of it?
Right. Thou shalt find him there first.
You shall find who the root of that design is. Read.
Mm-hmm. And though he pretend to help thee.
So he makes you feel like, oh, these projects are set up for you to get yourself on your feet.
Section 8 and all.
Section 8 is there to
wicked,
help you.
Wicked welfare.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
And though he pretend to help thee, yet shall he undermine thee.
Come on.
He will shake his head and clap his hands.
He's gonna shake it. So this situation of us being in these projects, being in these tenements, being just frustrated, being oppressed, he's actually enjoying this. Mm-hmm. What we don't realize is we are the so-called white man's true reality show.
Right.
He puts the camera, he puts us in the situation, and he films it all.
Right.
Right.
And bashes you over it.
And then calls you nigga, calls you good for nothing, calls right. you deadbeat daddy. Meanwhile, he gave you welfare and said daddy couldn't be there.
Right.
Now when daddy's not there, he's laughing and mocking you for your daddy not being there.
Right.
The design that you set up said my daddy couldn't be there.
Right.
That's right.
You know what's so heavy about that scripture, Officer Shimon? Can you read that again? Verse 17.
The book of Ecclesiasticus, chapter 12 and verse 17. If adversity come upon thee, thou shalt find him there first.
When the Most High sent the judgment to the island of Haiti, okay? The so-called Haitians, the tribe of Levi, okay? Who came first? What actor, well-known racist-ass actor came first? Sean Penn.
Oh.
With a shotgun.
With a shotgun, yeah.
He came with a shotgun.
He came quick.
That's the white man's nature right there.
He came quick as if he was trying to help the people, but he wasn't. He was there for the natural resource.
Came to kill.
That's what he's there for.
Hey, and you know what I just realized? Uh-huh. As you was reading that, officer, these conditions go all the way back to ancient Egypt. I got a book, the Atlas of the Bible, that shows we were living in the same quarters, shoulder to shoulder, in little room. Matter of fact, I brought that out in a video.
Right.
The rooms had two or three rooms attached to it, a little living room, little spaces there, and everybody used to chill up on the roof of these buildings, man, at nighttime. Okay, same thing you do today. That's what you got today, little row houses. Just like Goshen, just like Egypt, you're in spiritual Egypt now.
That's right.
So your hood is Goshen.
That's it.
Damn.
Huh. That's right.
Go back to that. Yeah, finish that out. There's more on that. No, it's from. I left it on the top. Okay. Yeah, in the ghettos. Yeah.
In the ghettos, government policy, municipal policy, for example, denied adequate services. Garbage wasn't collected frequently.
So the neighborhood looks like hell. Go ahead.
African Americans were crowded into neighborhoods in the ghetto because so much other housing was closed to them as a result.
So they forced you into these conditions. Go ahead.
Housing prices in the ghettos were much higher than similar housing in white areas.
So the white neighborhood is cleaner, is nicer, and they have better conditions. But you're paying more for your ungodly hell on earth conditions. Right. So that's another form of oppression. Right. Go ahead.
Rents were much higher than similar housing in white areas.
Go ahead.
Because you had a smaller supply.
Now, supply and demand. So there's not much supply in the ghetto. So we're going to raise the prices because we know they need these things. Go ahead.
Created slum conditions.
It did what?
Damn. This created slum conditions.
So this now create. You can't afford what you need. You're paying more than the white neighborhood that you want to live in because it's cleaner and it's nicer. But guess what? This now creates slum conditions. You're stuck there. Go ahead.
So when African Americans manage to break out of those slums.
So now let's say a brother makes it, like George Jefferson. He's moving on up, right? Here comes George moving on up. Because remember, let's take the Jeffersons for instance. Remember, because that was a show based on George Jefferson. He started his cleaning business and he was able to move out. Because before the show, The Jeffersons, he was on All in the Family, which is an offshoot of which started his Jeffersons, right? So he moved into Archie Bunker's Queens neighborhood from the Bronx, from his ghetto in the Bronx. He moves into Queens where Archie Bunker lives. Archie Bunker couldn't stand him.
It was like, there goes
the neighborhood, right? Remember that. Go ahead.
So when African Americans managed to break out of those slums and buy a home in a neighboring area.
In a neighboring area, go ahead.
Whites could be persuaded that slum conditions were going to be brought with them.
So there it goes right there. There goes the neighborhood. Man, oh, then we got these dirty niggas living up. They got garbage in there all over. They're going to come and do this. They're going to come and destroy our nice, peaceful, beautiful white neighborhood.
They're going to mess up our clean white air.
Yeah, they're going to be breathing up all the white man air.
Crooklyn.
Go ahead.
So the real estate agents would go into these neighborhoods.
So here's the policy now. The real estate agents would do what?
Go into these neighborhoods and try to panic white families into selling their homes cheap.
So now,
to the real estate agents.
Listen to how cunning the white man is against his own people too.
Oh yeah, he'll sell his mama.
He'll sell his own mama out. That's how profane Esau is. He's now telling them, there goes the neighborhood. Hey, you gotta sell your house and move. Y'all gotta move, man, because here come the Negroes. Go ahead.
But I want you to hear that key point. It said selling their homes cheap
to
real estate agents.
So now you sell the home cheap back to the real estate agent. Go ahead.
They use techniques. They would recruit blacks from the ghetto to walk around the neighborhood pushing baby carriages.
Pushing baby carriages.
They would phone call families in their white area and ask for names that were stereotypically African American.
So now they're rising up. What's the word? Propaganda.
Right.
Okay. Why they call asking for
Tyrone Johnson?
Tyrone Johnson here in my house. Ain't no Tyrone Johnson living in this neighborhood. But they're gathering momentum for them to sell their homes.
Man.
Go ahead.
Damn. All intended to give the impression that this was rapidly turning into another black slum.
So now my nice white Queens home and neighborhood is going to turn to a slum. Go ahead.
The white families who panicked would sell their homes to real estate agents.
They would sell their homes cheap to real estate agents.
Or the...
Let me see. Or what?
Speculators.
Speculators
at prices for low... That they were worth low below that what they were worth.
So now now the whites begin selling their homes to the real estate agencies below what they're worth. Now let's see what the real estate agents do with those homes.
The speculators would then turn around.
The speculators or real estate agents would turn around
and resell the homes to African Americans at far more than they were worth because of the restricted supply.
You hear that? The white man is the devil the Bible speaks of.
That's right.
The white man is the devil the Bible speaks of.
And this policy was called blockbusting.
That's where you get blockbusting from. It's called blockbusting. They get the white man to sell his home for cheap and scare the white man out of his home for cheap and resell it to the Negroes. At far greater price.
They always make their big money off the Negro, though.
Always make the big money off the Negro.
Always.
You got anything? You got anything else, officer?
You got more?
No. I'm
good. Let's go to Micah 2:2.
That's good.
That's
good. Yeah, you in the spirit, officer.
We need to pick man. You in the spirit.
That's right there. Man. All praise.
Read verse
I hope this is eye-opening for a lot of us, man, because this is a part of getting the wool taken from off the veil off your eyes, man, to see how we are the way we are, why we're in our situation, why we think the way we do. Okay? Go ahead, officer.
This is the book of Micah, chapter 2, and verse 1. Woe to them that devise iniquity.
See that? It says destruction to them that devise iniquity. See, iniquity, this iniquity is talking about, it's not something spur of the moment. Mm-hmm. It's something that's well thought out, it's well constructed, and well executed. These designs that we're reading about is something that they really had those think tanks?
Yes.
They sat around and came up with ways in order to oppress you. Mm-hmm. That's what they did. Read.
And work evil upon their beds. Mm-hmm. When the morning is light, they practice it.
So whatever evil that they devised, when the morning comes, they actually bring it to fruition. Mm-hmm. They make sure they carry it out. See, that's the thing about the difference between the Negro and the so-called white man. The Negro will say all day long, I'm gonna do this. I'm about that life. I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do that. But at the end of the day, they laugh at us because we ain't gonna do it.
Right.
But the Bible says they are going to do it. Whatever evil they devise in their minds and they sit down, ponder on it, figure out the blueprint on how to do it, they actually carry it out. Why? How do we know that? Because we're the products of that iniquity that they devise in these projects, in these tenements, in these row houses. Baltimore being built the way it is in those row houses, Philadelphia being built that way. You think that's by accident? That is by design. The evil that they devised in their beds, on in their minds, in their little corporate meetings, in their municipal meetings. What? Those things came to pass. Read.
Because it is in the power of their hands.
It is in the power of their hands. Mm-hmm. Come on.
And they covet fields.
They do what?
They covet fields.
So they covet fields. They lust after the goodly things that we have. Mm-hmm. One being our money. It's going to get into another one of those goodly things that we have that they lusted after. They lust after gaining, using us to be their guinea pigs. Because a lot of the medical breakthroughs you know about today is because we were those guinea pigs.
That's right.
They say, you know what? Look at that. Look at that stock lip Negro over there. Bring him over here so I can cut him up.
Right.
Right. No anesthesia.
No anesthesia. Come on.
And they covet fields and take them by violence.
So anything they want in this earth, the so-called white man, how do they take it?
And they covet fields and take them by violence.
When Christopher Columbus landed in Hispaniola, which is now Dominican Republic, and they saw how goodly our people lived, they said, you know what? I want this. And they didn't say, you know what? Can I buy this land from you? Can I buy part of the land from you? How did they get it?
Mm-hmm. And they covet fields and take them by violence.
They take it by violence. Remember, we read the blessing of Esau in Genesis 27. He shall live by the sword. That's the violence that he's talking about. You got something, bro?
50 acres. That's what they took from Will and French.
Yeah, wow.
Oh, man. Wow.
50 damn acres.
So they killed him. And that's, brother, this is what they, and I was going to bring that out earlier. This is what they do. They burn down our homes. When we flee, now that land is called abandoned. It's abandonment. So anyone can actually, the highest bidder can get that land. The highest bidder. There's a show that I saw that this woman bought a house in Detroit for $1 from the city. Why? Because it was under abandonment. So the house, so the city's like, what am I gonna do with it?
Yeah, they don't want to pay the taxes.
They don't want to pay the taxes on it, so she bought the house for $1. So that's something that has been perpetuated in these daggone wicked lands since the beginning of time, mainly with your family. So they killed these men, killed a grandfather, his brother, family members, and took 50 acres from them. You know how much 50 acres is worth today? That's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money. That's hundreds of thousands. A million, son.
Yeah. Read that, brother. Uh-huh. Read that top of two again.
Gotcha. Verse 2, Micah chapter 2:2. And they covet fields and take them by violence.
Now, here's the thing. They use this woman as a scapegoat. I'm going to tell you straight. Because Esau oftentimes, the so-called white man, oftentimes has an ulterior motive for why they do things. So some of those people might have been upset that a white woman was killed. But there were also those in those suits standing by saying, I think y'all should kill them all.
Right.
That you know that little voice in your ear? Right. The voice in your ear is that one standing on the side, because he knows when all of this comes to pass, I'm going to get the godly's 50 acres.
Right.
They know that.
That's something out of
habitual sacrifice.
Read.
Uh-huh. And houses.
And what else?
And houses.
Weren't we just reading about that in history?
Yes, sir, we were.
They take our houses as well. Because if they had the men that they thought did the crime, why did they burn down and run out every other black person in that town? Because they want those houses.
Yes, sir.
Come on.
And houses. And take them away.
And did what?
And take them away.
Come on.
So they oppress.
They do what?
They oppress.
Come on.
A man and his house.
So their job wasn't only to string up those men, allegedly, who allegedly did a crime, but they wanted to oppress that entire house. Not just that man, but his house. Not just the uncle, but his house. And a whole nation of people. Come on.
Excuse me. So they oppress a man and his house. Even a man and his heritage.
So this is why we know that Esau will never stop until the Most High sends Christ to stop him. He wants to oppress an entire heritage.
Right.
And guess what that heritage is? The children of Israel.
That's right.
That's who he wants to oppress. That's who he wants to put into these ghettos and do these damn case studies on. Uses as their damn guinea pigs, man. This is their true self we're reading about in the Bible. Because they talked to you at the water cooler, because they brought you some food in a potluck. This is their true nature we're reading about.
That's right.
You can't go against how God made them. You tell me you know him better than God?
Right.
This is their true nature. It's high time for our people to come up out of this damn stupor they're in, man.
Good officer. Yeah, just getting back to what Officer Shemiah said. In that Micah 2:2, it says at the bottom, because it is in the power of their hand. That's the blessing, like Officer Amaziah said. They shall live by the sword. That was the blessing. So what does that tell you? They don't have a home. They're vagabonds, man.
Damn right.
Right.
So they come in everybody else's fields. Atrocities, murders, lying, theft. But it's being revealed. The Most High is waking up the 144,000, man.
That's right.
We're going to bring this out, and we're going to continue to push this truth, man. All praise to the Most High, man.
Hey, all praise to the Most High.
Now that you just said something super heavy, you said it's being revealed.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go to 2 Thessalonians, chapter 2, and verse 3.
That's right.
Let's see.
This is the book of 2 Thessalonians. Chapter 2 and verse 3.
Come on.
And it says, let no man deceive you.
So let no man beguile you. Let no man trick you. Mm-hmm. Because when you, as the office has been bringing out super heavy historical facts about the condition we're in, is by design.
Right.
So now that you know that, how can any man deceive you any further?
That's right.
How can you still be deceived?
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come.
That day of Christ's return shall not come. Come on.
Except there come a falling away first.
Falling away what? Falling away into what? Into slavery, that's into right. bondage.
That's right.
That must happen first, because as Moses told the children of Israel in the wilderness, that there's the blessings or the cursings.
Right.
We chose the cursings.
Right.
So the Bible says that prophecy being fulfilled must happen first,
right,
before the return of Christ. Read.
And that the man of sin be revealed.
The man of sin be revealed. Mm-hmm. So there's someone in this earth that must be revealed. And as we've been bringing out, he's being revealed. His true self is being revealed this day. That he's the devil the Bible speaks of.
That's right.
That's right.
You understand that? The Bible says first our captivity, our slavery must happen. The second part of that is the man of sin must be revealed. Guess what that means? All people will once again have a general consent of who the damn devil is. He must be revealed. It's going to be so obvious and plain to you of who the devil is. That must happen first. Now, some of you may not repent. Some of you may not have full understanding of these scriptures. But there's one thing the Most High is going to make sure you know, is that Esau is the damn devil the Bible speaks of.
That's right. All praises to the Most High, man. All praises. We want to thank Brother Jared Godley for coming on the show.
All praises,
you know, all praises that the brother was able to come here and expound on his family, his family's heritage. You want to get in and speak, bro?
I want to thank you, brothers, for the audience. And just let our people know that this is not over. You know, this history is ongoing. It's not just 100 years, 200 years. It's been
since
more than
400 here.
Years, right. And it's still happening today.
Right.
This is not over by a long shot. And the Most High is right on point with the character of these people, and as always. But for any family out there listening, we got to do research. We got to open these books. We have to read mainly this history book, this Bible.
Right.
But a lot of other accompanying books, because the Most High is turning the light on.
That's right.
Most
That's
High
right.
is calling, and you got to wake up.
All praises to the Most High, man. So that's our show for today, brothers and sisters. I pray each and every one of you learned something today and got something out of the show. Don't forget, we got our podcast now. I believe we're on episode 14 or 15.
14 or 15.
So all praise to the Most High for these avenues that is allowing us to get this truth out, all right? Download the podcast, which is IUIC Podcast. You can download it to your smartphone or your PC, okay, to get these great lessons, man, these lessons of our bishops and deacons, okay? So download the podcast, rate, comment, share, okay? We also have a school in College Park, Georgia, 5134 Old National Highway in Atlanta, Georgia, 30349, all right? And sign up for online classes. Online classes are free. This knowledge is free, brothers and sisters. Right. So there's no, what's the word? No excuse for ignorance now. There's no excuse. You got brothers in IUIC. You got Israel United in Christ that teaches three times a day, 7 days a week for free. We're putting in work. That's you ain't gonna find that nowhere else.
That's right.
So what we have brothers and sisters that it'll fit your schedule. Okay, you gotta work in certain time periods, that's okay. When you get off, guess what? Somebody's gonna be on to teach you.
That's right.
Who you are, your nationality, and this Bible correctly. Not no damn Christianity.
That's right.
Okay, so all praise to the Most High for these avenues. Don't forget, if you want to donate to Israel United, United in Christ, you can donate to israelunite.org/donations. This is how we keep the truth going. This is how when certain things happen in Charleston, we're able to be there. We're able to put boots on the ground.
Ferguson.
When things happen in Ferguson, we're able to put boots on the ground. How? By collecting donations, okay? So donate to israelunite.org/donations. And support your nation, man. Because where else are we going to spend our money? Right back to Esau.
Right.
We ain't got nothing for ourselves. Right. All right? So donate to your people. Start supporting this truth so we can push this truth to the four corners of the earth and get the hell out of Babylon the Great.
That's right.
And with that, we say shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom, Israel.
Israel, you ain't no kin to me. If you don't fit the 12, then you my enemy. We are in the land of our captivity. Someday we going home, so you best believe. Read Deuteronomy 28 verse 15. It is a must that I show you this thing. It's cursed by the Most High God indeed. All cause we didn't wanna keep that law. Decide we wanna go off by some a fall. Some sacrifice they young. A lot of us commit a whore dumb. Hold up, the bunch of repent. They will know the name of the endure to the pain and they come to their flame.
I was reading in the book like a rap for a
verse 1 through 12 when it dawned on me. We all been warned, some don't believe. Today experience their fervor and heat. If you in sin, please don't stand next to me. Your flesh is consumed while you stand on your feet. Religion, lies, made to divide. Preachers, churches, rally the blind. Drugs was designed just to distort your mind. Illusion, confusion, you think that you're high. Black on black crime, that's an eye for an eye. It was all set in place just to make us collide. Open your Bible, reline up a line. Here a little, there a little, see what you find. Oh, wow, pastors ain't right. Taking y'all money and calling it tithe. Come out of them churches, you wasting your time. Think that you Christian, but really it's nice. We've been indoctrined by Protestant riots. The ones who enslaved us, now read us our rights. They used to kill if we read or we write. They claim guns and put pills on us, then give us life. If you not Israel, you ain't no kin to me. If you don't fit the 12, then you my enemy. We are in the land of our captivity. Someday we going home, so you best believe. If you not Israel, you ain't no kin to me. If you don't fit the 12, then you my enemy. We are in the land of our captivity. Someday we going home, so you best believe.
Open your eyes, time to awake. We make up the 12 tribes of Israel today. We the real Jews, make no mistakes. They in our homeland and only they faking. It ain't about color, it's more about race. God chose a nation to rule in this place. Jacob he loved, Esau he hate. You find that in Malachi 1 and verse trade. Trade, threats, you know, 3. Jerusalem is the motherland above and it's free. It's Galatians, Quattro, B-A-N-C. Get it? Got it? Friend, capiche? If I gotta fast for a couple of weeks just to get the kingdom, then the will let it be. I am keeping the laws, I keep every feast. Keep every Sabbath, break bread and I drink. Who's ready for Passover 2016? In the month of a favor, we gather in me. There's a whole lot of laughter, we dance and we be seen. I'm living for 7 days out the week. Can't wait to see what the elders gon' teach. Pull out my Bible, then pull out my seat. That's a spiritual food. Bon appetit. Some say truth hurts. Read it and weep. If you ain't tryna hear me, then move up the street. When I exit your city, I dust off my feet. Lace up my boots that's equipped with them clips. Lift up my voice like a trumpet in street. You can see my zeal, hear my zeal all in my speech. See that I'm serious, I don't show no teeth. We are imperial, define it and read. And can I be number like Sandor? Let me stop playing.
If you not Israel, you ain't no kin to me. If you don't fit the 12, then you my enemy. We are in the land of our captivity. Someday we going home, so you best believe. If you not Israel, you ain't no kin to me. If you don't fit the 12, then you my enemy. We are in the land of our captivity. Someday we going home, so you best believe.
Someday we going home, promise that. People look around, I'm confused, where's that? New Jerusalem, we gon' put on a match. Need 140 photos, put the nation on their back. Don't believe me? Okay, face fact, cause the facts still remain. Blackface under attack, man, you can't do this. Book of Judah, state that. Tell the 5 verse 2 and T, all facts. Who possesses slim, holy self, blameless. I got ride line 5, can't make up this. Fourth chapter, limitation ain't that a trust. They didn't look until this nation crying out for justice. My people smoked out, trying to figure what it is. Did the feels unreal, so they still on the hip. On the highway to hell, passed out behind the wheel. Death on the hill, but a cat down here. They don't see the roadblock, just a cop in the gun. Of a cock, it's fun, I'm caught in the sun. Kick a feed up, cheat up. Like it's nothing, I was fleet. We too weak to conceive what it's done. Cause my father is gone, the robbers is in. Burn us out of home, destroyed us to the point that we think it's crazy when they say we had a throne. None of this will happen if we ain't open the door. Then sin crashed in, death took a hold. Got us by the neck and they never let us go. Then came one of my savior, y'all. Stood by stiff in this world like a talk. He said, never trust your enemies. Stay on watch, we gon' suffer long in the armor of God. The gospel of peace on my feet. In the shower I walk, all I talk is the oracles of God. All I talk is the oracles of God.
Shalom, this. I'm Elder Nathaniel, Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to Join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC. To stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.